Hey guys, Momo Guru here, and I just wanted to talk to you guys a bit, especially a lot of you game developers out there that are trying to get their games up and running on Kongregate. I'll go ahead and tell you now, this video is not going to have a lot of actual video, not a lot of screen stuff going on, although I will be showing you and pointing out some important things you might want to keep an eye on. But, you know, I've been on Kongregate for a few years now. I've been developing games since I was a kid, but over the last few years, I've put up about 6 games on Kongregate. And, you know, in my opinion, only a few of them have done even remotely well. The last game I put up last year was a game called Starship Commander, and it seems to have done pretty well, considering, you know, the kind of feedback and plays that I've got on my other games. You know, it's really easy to get discouraged with Kongregate, especially if you're just a lone developer like me and you don't have the resources and the social, you know, networking, you know, channels to really push your game and get it out there to the masses that kind of gives you that boost you need in the beginning to get your game up into the rankings. Because essentially, if your game is going to survive on Kongregate, it is 100% about the rankings. All right, so let's start at the beginning here. When I released Starship Commander, I noticed I did something different than what I had done on my other games. In my other games, you know, I made the game, and granted, they're not bad games. They weren't horrible by any means. And it was confusing for me because I would see other games that just looked like it took a whole lot less effort on the developer's part, and their games had more plays and more ratings than my game. And I could not understand, you know, why was it that my games were doing so horrible. So, you know, before you jump to any conclusions here, I'm going to go ahead and show you some of my games that, you know, some of the earlier ones that are not horrible games. I couldn't understand why they weren't getting decent rankings. Let's take Protozoid, for instance. This game is a very simple game, nothing special. I'm going to turn the sound down here so it didn't blast you with an ad message. But basically, you can see this game has got 4,383 plays. This game was uploaded on May 17th of 2011, so that's, you know, almost 3 years ago. Sorry, I'm smoking a cigarette here. All right. So even if you look at Protozoid, this is not a bad game. This game it's clean. It's, you know, it works, it's functional, there's not a lot of bugs that are ruining it, you know, it's a simple game, it's a little simple shooter game. So why did this game fail? You know, what's wrong with this game? This looks like a very casual coffee table type, let me sit down and play for a few minutes. There's really, you know, not that much to the game. For example, if I can go ahead and die real quick, I'll show you. But basically, the mistakes that I made with this game, you know, as I was just getting into putting games up on Kongregate, I didn't understand how things worked on this website, and it became very, very frustrating. And you know, you almost get, you know, disheartened to even trying to release your games and stuff on there because it just, they don't do well. And it almost seems like the only people that comment are the people that have something negative to say. And it was just very disheartening. Anyway, so you can see there's Protozoid. Here's another game I did, Kingdoms. Again, not a very popular game. It didn't really go over that well. Now, granted, you know, I learned some things about the types of games that I like to make. Now, I'm much older than probably a lot of the younger developers out there. I'll be 40 here next year. And you can see this game, I got rated at 2.73, 6,000 plays. Nothing too special. The game is clean. You know, it's got everything you need to be a decent game. You've got all your little options and mouse overs. I did unique graphics. I tried to make, you know, the game is simple. It's not too crazy. But for the most part, you know, it's a good game. It's not a bad game at all. So why did it do so poorly on Kongregate? So that's what I'm focusing on in this video, and I want to show you something. So by releasing these earlier games, the first game that I had any kind of success with was this one that I released last year. This one's called Starship Commander. Now, this game is, I'm not going to resize my video so you can see everything, but you can see I got a much better rating on this game. I got a 3.7 with over 4,000 ratings. You know, a lot of people rated the game. It's got a decent amount of plays, 16,000 plays, and I even had 22 likes on Facebook, which was quite remarkable for this game. This game's a little bit different. You know, this is the kind of game where you jump in and you control a galaxy and you're trying to build fleets and you know, it's much more of a longer game. It's not a casual game. This game was a lot more complicated. There were lots of things to learn and lots of things to explore and do and see. And, you know, I noticed that this game did got a lot more plays, did a lot better because the players kept coming back to play again. It had something about the game that was captivating. So when I released this game, I did something different than I had ever done before. And I decided I was going to interact with the community. I said, look, I accepted the fact that the game was going to flop. I really was quite surprised that it even got over 3.5 stars, considering that my other games had not done well at all. I couldn't even get over 3 stars. And when I show you the ranking stuff, then you'll understand why that's important. But right now, you know, when I released that game, I was like, wow, here's something a lot different. You know, I decided I was going to interact with the community. I was going to try to reply to every single one of the comments that people were making and things that people were saying. I was going to try to let them know that I was listening to them. And something remarkable happened. People really got on board. They got on board so much that they literally transformed the mechanics of the game. Now, granted, I programmed it and I'm the one that made the final decisions, but some of the ideas that these players had were things that in the 6 months it took me to make that game, I had never thought of once. And at that point, I realized, wait a minute here. There is something to be said. There is some value in engaging the community. So I started to look at some of the other top games, and I was noticing that the developers were not really engaging the community on Kongregate. They weren't interested in, you know, commenting to everything that everybody said. And granted, a lot of those top games are built by game development companies, so the ownership isn't quite there. Yeah, there's a guy sitting behind a computer that took hours and hours and hours and drew all of that great art that in the game that you're seeing, but as far as he's concerned, that was just a small drop in the bucket considered to the very big scope of that game. So he didn't feel like he owned that game. Just like the guy who sat there and modeled all the cool 3D stuff, or the guy that sat there and programmed all the sound effects. You know, they didn't feel like they owned it, like it was their game. And with indie developers, you know, we take that stuff personally. When you tell me my game sucks, man, that's a knife in the heart. I'm like, wow, I really missed the mark here. Because not only am I trying to make something for myself that I enjoy to play, but I want other people to enjoy it too. And, you know, telling somebody their game is shit, man, that's fucking, it sucks. You know, especially if you're just a solo developer like myself. So I really engaged the community with Starship Commander, and all the ideas and things that I got from these players, I listened to them. And I removed my own ego from it. I removed what I thought should be the way it should be. And I started to notice that, you know, when more and more players were requesting a particular feature and I put that feature in, well, all of a sudden my rating changed a little bit. It went up just a little bit more because that player felt like it was part him too. Granted, there were 15 other people that all said, hey, you need to put this on there or you should consider doing this. But because I made that change, that player felt, wow, this guy is genuinely interested in listening to our feedback. And you can see that he cares about his game. And the very opposite started to happen, to where players were now, instead of, you know, posting negative comments and writing, you know, just this game sucks, or you should have did this, or it's missing that, or I'm not reading this tutorial, or whatever, you know, the general comments are, you know, players started to flip it around a little bit. And then all of a sudden it became, hey, you know, I've got an idea for you. So the comments became a lot less negative and a lot more constructive. And when they saw that the developer was interested in those constructive comments, it totally changed the dynamic. It changed the feel of just sitting on that page, to where now other players were like, wow, you know, normally I'd rate this a 3, but just because you've been doing so much work on this and I know the game is going to be much better, I'm going to give you that extra star just because I know that within the month that I don't play, and if I come back and check it, the game really will have earned that extra star. And in most cases, it did, especially in Starship Commander. So, let's talk about the ratings. Why is it important that you're getting ratings? Well, the ratings are what's going to keep you on these charts, because there are, you can look at the top here, 83,000 games on this site. Now, you tell me what's going to make your game stand out. Well, you're going to have to get some kind of ratings. And it's very difficult to compete with ratings when you've got guys and developers on this site, you know, that are putting together games that have a team of people. I mean, this game was released in August 30th of 2013. It's already got 3 million plays. 3 million plays is a lot of exposure. And when you get a game up with 3 million plays, you better believe that some of those people are going to come back and look at your next game. So it's almost like a social networking type situation where, you know, the more friends you have, then the more exposure to your ideas you're going to, you know, that's going to propagate throughout the internet, the more people are going to share those ideas, and it just kind of continues. You know, it's exponential. But to get into that tier is almost impossible unless you've established yourself as a solo developer, which practically all of us solo indie developers have not and probably never will. So you got to get on the rankings. So let's take a look at some of the basic rankings. Let's jump into Adventure RPG, right? Very high category. You can see some of the top games here, 6.6 million plays, 4.1 million plays. You know, these games have gotten some wear and tear going on. The Epic Fantasy 3, almost 10 million plays. That is a huge number of people playing a small indie game. Now, granted, a lot of these games on here aren't indie games at all. They're done by development studios. So once you get onto these rankings, now it's going to be easy for players to find your game. So all of a sudden, you end up, you're like, I want to play some adventure RPG game. And you're like, Epic Fantasy. And you go over and you look and you'll notice they got these little arrows. And you're actually looking at screens of the game. Now, this is important. This is something that so many indie developers are just not cluing into. Why is it important that you put screenshots on your game? Let me tell you why. Give me 1 second. I'm going to put my cigarette out. I know this video is long, but it's full of some secret information, so fucking pay attention. All right, why is it important that you put screenshots on your game? Because if you have a game that doesn't have the screenshots on it, right? Now, it so happens that I've clicked into Adventure RPG, so I expect that every game in here is going to be an Adventure RPG game. So when I mouse over a game and it doesn't have any screenshots, well, Enchanted Cave, well, just the name of that game sounds great. I want to try it, right? But I don't see any screenshots on that game. I just see this one little screenshot. So I move over here and I click play now and it loads the game up. And all of a sudden I realize that's not what I thought it was. I didn't want that. Well, there are a lot of players that will rate your game a 1 simply because it was not what they wanted. They thought they were going to get lemon, and you produced a lime, and they're like, yeah, that's not what I wanted. I thought it was going to be lemon. So they give you a 1. It could have been the best fucking lime in the entire world. It could have had sprinkles coming out of it. Doesn't matter. It's not what they wanted. So because it's not what they wanted, they rate you low. And they rate you low really, really fast, right off the bat. Because as soon as you launch your game, you're going to go into a category called under judgment, where there are no ratings showing. You can see all of these games have no stars showing, and they have very few plays. And it takes a while for you to get out of that underrating. I think it's about, you know, right around 250 to 300 plays or so. And once you get enough ratings and enough plays, then you fall out from under judgment. So if you're looking at, let's say, this game here, Rocket Weasel. Now, Rocket Weasel could mean so many different things. But now that I see the screenshots, see, he's got screenshots on the game, I look and I say, this game looks very much like Flappy Bird. I'm not interested in playing a Flappy Bird game, so I'm not going to play this guy's game, right? But if I didn't know that, if I thought Rocket Weasel was the only screenshot I saw, and I click Rocket Weasel to find out it's like Flappy Bird, I'm going to rate it a 1, because that's not cool. I don't give a fuck about Flappy Bird, and it means 2 shits to me. Here's another one, another Flappy Bird clone, Phoenix, or whatever. I'm just guessing it's a Flappy Bird, because they're doing the same kind of little, just put one little flying thing on the screen, and that's what it is. So, looking at Rocket Weasel, for example, this could probably be a great game, but it's not the kind of game that I want to play. Now, the kind of games that I make may not be the kind of game that this guy wants to play. So when he goes and looks at my screenshots and he says, oh, before I have to sit there and watch an ad and load up the page and wait for the ad to be done, wait for the game to load, only to discover that the game is not what I wanted it to be, well, I've wasted a few minutes of whatever precious time I have. And depending on how I feel that day, you might just get 1 star simply because... quite simply because it was not what I expected to see. Well, that's how can a developer tell you what he's presenting, you know, so that you don't expect that it's something that it's not? Well, here's where it gets tricky. Your description. You can see you got less than what? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15 words. You get 15 words to explain to somebody what the game is. And not only that, you get a title, right? So the title with your 15 words is all in your screenshots is going to be the packaging of your game. And when you put that packaging on Kongregate, are you going to put your game that you worked 6 months on in a white box that has, you know, crayon written on it that says, this is my crap game? No. You want to make yourself a really nice box. You want to make yourself a box that's going to represent what is inside the game. Now, this can backfire on you. You make a badass graphics with some really cool screenshots, and the player jumps in the game thinking this is going to be awesome, and he plays for 20 minutes only to discover that the screenshots you put on your thing were cutscene screens, and you know, all the fancy whatever features you had are you have to pay for them, there's some kind of, you know, paid premium thing, it's going to piss them off. They're going to be like, I've been had. This is not what I thought it was. And again, you get a low rating for it. So how do you convey to a person what, you know, what the game is about? Number one, you've got the name. So we've got Angry Pig. Well, just by the name alone, I can assume that it's some kind of like Angry Birds. Let's see how well he did with the description. Play the game and tag the birds. All right, so in this title, he's got Angry. In his description, he's got Bird. And then we look at the screenshot. We've only got one. It's got the little guys from Angry Birds. Well, I'm almost positive. Without playing this game is going to be like Angry Birds. Not my type of game. Not interested. I'm not going to play it. Now, does it hurt this guy because he doesn't get an extra play from me? Let me ask you, what do you think is more important? That I play his game and boost this up to 24 plays? Or that I play his game that I'm not into and I rate it a 2? Not because it's a bad game, but just it's not my cup of tea. And I'd really rather Kongregate stop putting those games on the site because I want a website that only puts the games I want to play on. Well, as selfish as that is, that's the majority of players out there. They don't want to see all this extra crap that has nothing to do with anything they're interested in. They want to see the shit that they came to the site to play. They're very particular. They're very picky. Now, granted, they're always open. You know, a lot of the players are open to new stuff, and they want to go and see and see, you know, what else is out there and try to find their next favorite game. But they are going to have to weed through so much shit. So many crap games that have taken no kind of talent, no kind of artistic vision, and you know they made it onto the site, and now all these people are forced to wade through all this shit looking for one little rose. Well, how do you make your little rose stand out? Number one, state what it is. So name your game as close to what it is as you can. My game, Starship Commander. What do you think Starship Commander's about? The name should tell you everything right there. And then you've got 15 to 20 words here to describe what your game is. So use this information. Use that to make sure that you can convey what your game is about. If you've got a lot of upgrades in your games and things like that, which players really like, make sure you put a screenshot of that shit. So when they're clicking through, they go, oh, wow, look at that. That shop has a ton of items. Look how small his scroll bar is and how long he's got to scroll. That shop must have a bunch of items in it. This must have be a kind of game where I'm going to earn some money and buy some items and upgrade my stuff. So absolutely, that's the kind of game I want to play. I'm going to click through it. And that way, after I click through it and I'm actually playing the game, I say, wow, this is pretty close to what I like. Now, no longer am I judging the game on whether or not it was what I expected, you know, for the game genre. Now I'm judging it on how well it was done, which is now taking you to the next level. So make sure that you're naming your games and putting a description that captivates people. Make sure you use all 5 of your screenshots. Put them up there. You want people to see what your game is. Even if they don't like it, that's actually better. If they don't like what they see in the screenshots, it's better they don't play your game. Because if they do and rate it, they're going to hurt your rating. And in the long run, the longevity of your game on Kongregate is going to be very short. You're going to get a few days being in the first or second, third page maybe, and then you're gone. And once you start falling on those back 15 to thousands of pages, nobody's going to play your game. You'll be lucky to get a few plays every month. All right. So with that said, let's talk about this. When you come out from under judgment, you've got no stars, right? Now you get a rating, right? So let's say everybody that played Madness Trip rates it 4, right? So we look at Madness Trip. I see a car jump in there. I see there's first, second, and third place. I'm guessing this is some kind of racing game, right? And then I get over here. Ever drive across the continents? This is the challenge offered by Madness Trip, right? So I can already tell this is a racing game. Again, not my cup of tea. Me personally, I like strategy games and adventure games and things like that. So I'm not going to click this guy's game and rate him a 1 because I thought it was, you know, Grand Theft Auto. No, I can clearly see by his screenshots what it is. But if you put a Grand Theft Auto looking image right here and they click your game only to find out these are what's in the game, they feel like they got gypped and your rating falls. All right, so now you're under judgment. We'll say Madness Trip has jumped up. Every person that's played the game, all 5 of them, give it 4 stars. All of a sudden, Madness Trip is going to pop up in its respective categories. Now, you'll notice these Under Judgment games don't have any tags here because the players themselves are rating and voting on the tags that you've selected when you uploaded the game. So you need to be very careful. You don't want to put a sport racing game inside of a strategy defense category. If you do, people will downvote your game simply because it's not what they expected to see. So again, make sure that you're paying attention to these tags and these categories. If you're not sure if your game belongs in a category, go and test the other games. Go and play the other games that are in that category, because that's going to help show you what games are important and what games belong there and what games don't. And you'll see, the players will tell you straight up, this doesn't belong here, 1 out of 5. I've had people give me 1 out of 5 because they said they didn't want to read 2 paragraphs of text. I'm talking less than what you're seeing right here on the screen, just right here where I'm moving my mouse. They didn't want to read that, so they give it a 1. People are very, very fickle about this, so it's important that you're trying to do everything you possibly can not to make the player say, ah, fuck this, because they do it so quickly. They've been treading through crap games all freaking day. They don't have a lot of time to play. If they're looking for a new game, they don't want to waste their time going through 20,000 crap ones. And by the time they get to yours, and yours is not exactly what they thought it was, they're just going to rate you like they rated all the other ones. All right. And I'm not saying there's not nice guys out there that objectively rate. I'm just saying in general, these are the trends that I've noticed over the past few years. And, you know, I've put up 6 games now, and my last game is doing really good. And I'll get to that, but I just want to show you how this is going. All right, so I put my game in an adventure RPG, right? Because I like adventure RPG games. And you'll notice it has RPG, fantasy. If you mouse over, you'll get RPG, fantasy, adventure, and turn-based. So you get all of these extra tags, right? So if I'm into fantasy-type games and I click the fantasy tab, it's going to take me into a category where it's got all of these fantasy games. And you can see it's all done by ratings. Now, granted, you can sort them by highest rated, most played, newest, oldest. But what's really getting the plays are these first 1, maybe 2 pages. You know, players might have enough time to click through 3 or 4 or 5, but, you know, that's a lot of games that are going to be exposed to before they get to yours. There's a lot of chances they're going to find something better than yours or something that just captivates them long enough to never get to yours. They're not going to make it to that next page to see your game and go, that's the greatest game I've ever seen. They didn't get that far because they got trapped here playing Epic Fantasy 4 or Nightmare Tower right there on the front page of the fantasy tab. So, again, make sure you're putting your categories here the best you can, because although the players will adjust them, for the most part, when it first comes out, that's what's going to help get your rating up. So if you put your games in the proper categories, players looking or interested in those types of games are going to give it a whirl. And if you've done your job and you've done well, then your game will succeed or have a chance of succeeding. Because, I mean, a lot of this is lottery anyway. All right, so let's take a look at this. So now you've got your awesome game up. It's doing really good, and before you know it, it starts to pop up in this category down here, top games of the month, right? So now your game's doing good, but here's where it dies, and you just don't understand what happened. All right, so let's take a look. Top games of the month. We have got a collection of games here. We've got Ballistics, we got a first-person shooter. We've got an idle-type gamer. I've played these before. They're very strange, but they seem to be quite popular. I don't get it. This game was really actually pretty cool. This one was like a city building type game. Loot Heroes. You see all these different games are all different genres and all different categories. Well, normally for a lot of players, this part right here is the kiss of death. It either makes or breaks your game. And the reason why is because all of a sudden you have a page, right? Hot new games of the month. It's every single game. It's all categories. Right, you've got dungeon games, point and click, action, 3D, combat arenas, space, science fiction, ninja. I mean, there are so many different categories here that if you're just going through the games and testing them out, you're going to find games that aren't your cup of tea. Now, granted, we scroll up here and take a look at Learning to Fly Idle. This game is not my cup of tea. This fucking game has almost 500,000 plays. It was uploaded on the 17th. Today is the 28th. So in 11 days, it managed to rack up 500,000 plays. Obviously, there are people out there that are very into this game. But if I click this game and I play this game, I'm like, this is crap, man. Like, the graphics suck. This guy like didn't even bother making decent buttons. The music is just a 30-second loop. I'm not interested in playing this crap. Like, this is a garbage game to me. I would rate that game a 1. I'm not saying I rated this game a 1. I'm just saying, I playing those types of games, I'm not interested. I've seen a few of them already, right? Then, you know, other players that are getting on this, this is exactly what they're looking for. So, what ends up happening? It's like you're at, you know, it's like you go to a mall, and all of us indie developers all make music, right? And we each made one song, and one guy gets up and he plays this dubstep song that just makes everybody go crazy. And they're like, man, that was incredible, right? And then I get up there and bust out this, you know, Johnny Cash style country western song, and half the people walk away. And I'm like, now, my song took a long time to work on. I composed it. It was from the heart. You know, it told a story. It did all of these things. And this other guy made a bunch of beeps and boops. And all of a sudden, somehow, his song is better than mine. Well, what has happened is we both played our songs to the masses. And it just so happens that the majority of kids hanging out at the mall are going to be a little bit more into dubstep than they are into Johnny Cash. Does it mean my game sucks? Does it mean my game is not worth it and I should quit as a developer? No. What is happening is the players that don't like country music, you're playing a country music song. They're like, no thanks. Well, you put that country music song in front of a lot of people when you land here on the top monthly games. So your rating is going up. You're like, holy, I started at 3.5. Now I'm up to 3.8. Now I'm up to, you know, 3.9. Oh my God, I'm about to bake 4 stars. You get onto this monthly game page and you're like, oh my God, look, I made it on the hot games of the month. My rating is going to skyrocket. My plays are going to go through the roof. And the exact opposite happens. People start bitching. The rating falls like pretty quickly. And you're like, what the fuck? Like, that's crap. The first couple times it happened to me on my games, I honestly thought, like, oh man, that's crap. You know, all these other developers are just rating your game down so that their games do better. That's not the case. Don't think that the other developers are, you know, I'm not saying that they don't have time to go through and rate some games once, but they got better things to do. They're out there working on their new big game that's going to get 4.5 stars and make them, you know, a shitload of money across the web. So when you're putting your game on the table, that is a very niche type of game. It's a kind of game that not a lot of people are into. And then you put a game up that's a, you know, a tower defense type game that, you know, most the majority of people can appreciate and have some kind of enjoyment out of. Well, you know, well, which one's going to do better? Well, obviously the tower defense game's going to do better because it's going to appeal to more people. Now, does that mean that your game cannot be one of those magical little gems, one of those niche games that, you know, do really well even though it's not for the masses? And the answer to that is no. Your game can do really well. And I believe that's what happened to my game. Now, my game that I just released here is called Astrox. It is now on the top monthly games. It's up in the number 2 spot, right? So let me go back to the homepage. It sat in hot new games for a little while. And then once I broke 4 stars, it jumped into the hot new games right on the main page. You'll notice when you mouse over my game, I've got detailed screenshots showing you what the game looks like, what's going on inside. A little bit of eye candy, a little bit of functionality, a little bit of upgrades. You're showing all the different aspects so that the player says, wow, you know, just looking at this one screenshot, there's all these different colored dots. That has to mean they're different things. There's something up here. I have no idea what that is. But if you look here, there's all kinds of upgrades or active modules. This looks like it's got some kind of health bars and stuff. This is a spaceship game. You look at my tags, space, mining, upgrades, 3D, and sandbox. So although I picked a lot of those tags, I don't get to choose how well those tags do. The other players do. So once that game got onto hot new games, right, it started to get a lot more plays. And something very strange happened. Normally, the best I've ever made it on, my game Codelink, which is a hacker-type game, made it into top games of the month in the first spot right here. Now, this is below the fold, as they say in the web world. So you had to scroll down a little bit just to see my game. And I got a lot of plays on that game pretty quick, you know, because I made it up on the homepage. But with Astrox, it was different. Now, personally, the reason I think Astrox has done so well, I'm not going to demo the game in this video, but the reason I think it's done so well is because it did something that my other games didn't. A lot of my games always focused on functionality, focused on game mechanics, gameplay, things like that. I never, you know, my graphics were never bad. I always tried to make nice, pleasing graphics, but I never went above and beyond. And now that I started developing in Unity, I kind of had a little bit of the ability to really spruce things up and make things, you know, look beautiful. And what I think happened with Astrox, because it's a very niche game. It's a space mining game where you run around and fight pirates. It's not a desktop defense towers. It's not an idle kind of game where you just sit back and, you know, let whatever fall wherever it's supposed to and collect your treasures and stuff. It's a very different game. But the reason I think it did so well was because of some of the graphics and the music. So the players that aren't into country music came to my country music game. And I distracted them from the country music. I showed them good graphics. I gave them good music. And all of a sudden, they said, even though this isn't my cup of tea, even though this isn't the kind of game that I want to sit and play for the next 10 hours, I'm not going to rate this a 1. Because this is it looks to me like a very nice game. So instead of giving it that 1 rating that I would normally give, I'm going to give it a 3. Well, guess what? It didn't crush my ratings, which is normally what happens when you make it onto these homepages. Your rate, in my opinion, in the data, I've been writing these stats down. I have, you know, for all of my games, I can see where I'm like, I've got little markers that show when I made it onto the homepage, how many plays I had, how many votes I had, what rating I was at, how many likes on Facebook I had, how many comments I had that day. I was tracking all of this data manually. I'm just writing it down on paper like every hour. And I noticed that as soon as I made it onto the homepage, my plays increased greatly. My ratings, the number of ratings I had increased greatly, but my overall rating would drop every time. And Astrox was different. Astrox didn't do that. It did the opposite. As soon as it made it onto the homepage, the rating went up. And there's a lot of little details that you have to do to make it so that people don't bash your game. But I honestly believe that one of the main reasons that it didn't get bashed and it was actually given enough of a chance that people played it and said, hey, this isn't a bad game. This is actually really fun, was because of the graphics and the music and the environment. So even though you'd landed in a game that you're not interested in, you landed in the type of genre that you wouldn't normally play, it gave you just enough to say, this isn't a bad game. I'm not going to play it to the end. I'm not going to explore everything there is to see. I can see I'm going to have to go through this tutorial that's going to take me 10 minutes. I see that I'm going to have to learn how all of this stuff works because it's not a simple little casual coffee table game. It's got a little complexity to it. So, you know, because of that, it actually gave me a chance. It gave me enough of a chance to get up onto that homepage. Where I'm at now, I uploaded this game on March 23rd. Right now, I have 168,000 plays, almost 169,000 plays. And we'll go ahead and scroll here over to the side. And I'm going to have to wait for that ad to play. I've got a 4.23 or a 4.24 rating. Does it show me right there? I guess it did. No, it's not. Yeah, 4.24. And I've got 6,940 votes, right? So in 5 days, this single game has surpassed the ratings and the plays and the votes of all of my previous five games put together in just 5 days. Now, granted, the game is not a bad game. It's a good game. But you can see just from the number of plays and the ratings, the top comments, what the players were looking for. Now, some of the negative comments I got, I could probably shoot through here and I could probably find some. Ooh, there's a negative one. Let's see what that. Oh, that's just an advertisement. So there are. Sorry, I got distracted reading those comments. But you know, some of the negative comments that I got on the game were things like, you know, the tutorial was too long. One of the negative comments I got. If your game is in any way similar to anything else that the person has played, if they're having a bad day or they're just in a shitty mood, they'll fucking rate you down. I've had people say like, oh, you just ripped off EVE Online or, you know, no, I didn't. It's a completely different game. I'm sorry that the mechanics look similar or that some of the functionality is similar. But, you know, EVE Online was a rip of a million games going all the way back to some of the earliest, you know, space games. One of my favorite, Star Control, or which eventually became Master of Orion. So, you know, you can't say that anybody's stealing a game unless they're just straight up fucking ripping it. Like, you know, making a Flappy Bird clone. Well, there's a difference between making a Flappy Bird clone and making a space mining game where you trade and fight pirates. There are probably fucking 50 space mining games out there where you trade and fight pirates. What makes mine so special? The fact that it's free and it's on Kongregate. And it's of the same quality to a degree. All right. So I hope I gave you a little insight to how some of these rankings and ratings work. I think once, you know, this isn't over yet, but I've also noticed that in the contests is another thing you got to watch out for. As soon as you break into the contest, these guys will vote you down. You know, you're competing for money. Top prize, which I'm currently sitting in number one spot, the top prize is $1,500 for the month. And then you're also in the weekly contest, which is another $250. So depending, you know, you put out a high quality game that wins weekly and monthly, you just got $1,750. Not to mention all the plays and promotion and the future attractions for other games that you put out. But as soon as you get onto these contest lists, you know, if you've got a developer that's working for a studio, and there are 20 people that work at that studio, and you're in competition with their game, you don't think all 20 of those guys are going and rating you down to one, or that all 20 of those guys rated their game to five? And here you are all by yourself. You're just one little guy. You rated your game to five. Even if you went and rated everybody one, which don't do, man. That'll just fuck up your karma. But even if you did that, this is a drop in the bucket, man. You're not doing anything to their games. But because they have the masses and the promotion and the social networking and all of the things that go in along with the studio, you know, they promo their game on their websites. I don't have a website for Astrox. There is no like place that you can go that says, here, go to Kongregate and rate the game 5 stars and win a free, you know, t-shirt. No, there's no such thing as like that. But anyway, so I just wanted to give you a couple little things that I've noticed about the ratings. Just to recap, make sure you do your screenshots and your descriptions. You don't want people to play your game that's going to rate it a 1 because it's not what they thought it was supposed to be. You'd rather those people not play your game. You would rather get a very high rating, which will bring up the people that are interested in that game because they're finding it highly rated in the categories that it's supposed to be. Expect your rating to drop once you get onto the homepage. You get any kind of homepage feature, your ratings go down a little bit. And it may take a while for them to come back up. And that does happen. Once you fall off the homepage, now you're not exposing your country music song to the mall. Now the only people finding your country music song are the people that are going into the music store and looking in the country music section and finding your song and listening to it and go, this is a great song. I'm going to give you 5 stars. So remember that. You're going to go down when you hit the homepage, but then you go back up after you get off the homepage because now you're back into whatever little category you are. Depending on how much of a splash you make, you want to get in up into those top categories. Astrox is going to do well for a long time. Why? Because in the space category, you can see I'm number 3. So that means you pull me off the homepage, my plays are still going up. I'm still getting the same plays. And even better, my rating is going to go up because the people that are finding my game are looking for it in the respective categories. Under the mining category, I made it to number 1. That's just remarkable to me. Under upgrades, I think I'm on like the second page. Sandbox, I think I made it onto the first page. Holy crap, I made it up to the second spot on Sandbox. All right, so this game's going to be, you know, I've got in the top 3 in a couple different categories. It's going to give me the longevity to, you know, get this game some decent amount of plays. You know, personally, I'd be surprised if this game doesn't break 1 million plays or more in the next few months. Just because it's got enough of the ratings that, granted, I'm on the homepage right now, 170,000 views came in the last few days just because of the homepage. When I get off the homepage, I'll be lucky to get 1,000 plays a day. But those days add up. That's 30,000 plays a month. You know, those add up quite quickly. So I'd be very surprised if I don't break 1 million plays on Astrox. I think I'm pretty well on my way. But anyway, I just wanted to kind of cover some of the things you need to do and some of the things to expect when you're putting out your indie games on Kongregate, because it's brutal out here, man. And to be honest with you, when I released this game, I didn't expect it to be any different than any of the other games that I've released. The only thing that I did different was try to pay a lot more attention to the details that other people complained about in my previous games. You know, things like make sure you have, you know, mute sound and mute music. You know, simple things. Make sure your game auto-saves. Make sure, you know, that there's some way that the players can understand how to get started playing the game, whether it's a tutorial or just a simple little mission that kind of guides you through however you do it. Make sure you can teach them to play it. And don't take too long. Some of the biggest complaints I get on all of my games is that my tutorials take too long. They're too wordy. You know, people in this day and age, when I grew up playing games, you'd be lucky if it had graphics. There's a lot of text. That's all you did was read. You know, and the game was part of your imagination. The kids that are playing these games these days, they don't got time for that shit. We grew up playing Atari and fucking ColecoVision. They're playing more iPads and smartphones by the time they're 10 than you've ever had the chance to play through your entire childhood. So just keep in mind that the games that the kids are playing today are not the games that we used to play when we were young. So if you're a developer that's stuck on making the games that you liked to play when you were little, keep in mind and accept the fact that it probably won't do very well in the mass markets of online casual gaming. All right, guys, I know I rambled on for a long time. God, I hope you get some kind of use out of this. Momoguru signing out. Make sure you subscribe, and I'll be back with more info.